scripture song. If you'd like to follow along with us, we're going to be in 2 Timothy chapter 3.
This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, unkind and fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God,
having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. From such turn away, for of this sort are they which creep
into houses and lead captive silly women laden with sins, led away with diverse lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth.
Men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith, but they shall proceed no further, for their folly shall be manifest unto all men, as theirs also was. But thou hast fully known my doctrine,
manner of life, purpose, faith, long suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions which came unto me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, what persecutions I endured. But out of them all the Lord delivered me.
Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived.
But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works.
2 Corinthians chapter 1. Well, that's a blessing, the songs, amen. Praise the Lord, ministering to us in song. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. And look with me, if you would, at verse, we're going to start and end in verse 3. We're just going to read the first part of verse 3. It says, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Now, Father, I do pray, Lord, that you would just continue, Lord, blessing this congregation. Thank you, Father, for the songs you give us. Thank you for your presence. Lord, thank you for the ministering of your Holy Spirit upon our souls. It is truly a blessing, Father. And Lord, we're asking that you would enter in, Father, that this message would be full of you. God, you would inhabit the words, and Lord, you would accomplish in our hearts, Father, the very things you desire it to accomplish. And Father, I thank you for the message. I thank you for the truth of this message. And I just ask you, Father in heaven, that, Lord, your word would take effect upon our souls for Jesus' sake. And in thy name I do pray. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Take your Bible for a minute and turn to Matthew chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3. Blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Matthew chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3, and if you would look down at verse 16, Matthew chapter 3, verse 16. It says, "And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him." And in verse 17, it says, "And lo, a voice from heaven saying, This is my beloved Son." Now, brethren, if I was standing near the River Jordan when this took place, and Jesus Christ comes up to John the Baptist, and they have a little discussion, and of course that discussion is John the Baptist says, "Man, I need to be baptized to you. Why are you coming to me?" And Jesus just says, "Suffer it for us now to fulfill all righteousness." And they're talking there for a minute, and all of a sudden, if you're on the banks of the River Jordan, you're watching John the Baptist take this man who looks just like any other normal man, normal human being, and they have that little discussion, and then down into the water goes our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, and back up out of the water he comes. But something happens when this man comes up out of the water. When this one comes up out of the water, something took place that never took place before. It never took place again afterwards, and it's never going to take place ever again. But when this one comes up out of the water, the Holy Spirit descended like a dove in a bodily shape and lit upon our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and went into that vessel. And there was a voice from heaven which said, "This is my beloved." And right about that time, the people on the River Jordan are going like this right here, thinking, "Oh my God." And I mean, can you imagine what it would be like to stand there and hear God speak audibly? I've never had that privilege to have God speak to me audibly. But here the Lord is being baptized, and the men are standing around, the women are standing around, and they hear, "This is my beloved Son." Take your Bible, and you ain't got to go there. John, how many of you know John 3:16 by heart? Amen. You know what the Bible says? "For God, the living God, for God so loved the world that he's a person. He is an entity. He is a person. He has thoughts. He has reason. He has action." And the Bible says tonight, it says, "Blessed be God." And I'm going to bring a message tonight on blessed be God. Blessed be God. I tell you what, we serve a great God. And I am so thankful tonight that I am saved by this great God. And Jesus Christ one time said, he said in John chapter 11, he says about his sheep, "My sheep hear my voice and they follow me, and I give unto them eternal life and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my Father's hand." My Father! Jesus Christ had a relationship with another being, not just himself. Oftentimes as Christians we get the idea that we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, which is true. He is my brother. But the God of the universe that sent us his Son, he is a person. And Jesus Christ says, "Of that person, my Father, which gave them me, is greater than all." You know what I think Christ would have you to want? A relationship with God the Father. I think he would want you to realize that God the Father and I, yes, I am part of him. Yes, I came out from him. But he is a person. And he sent me. What we owe to God is phenomenal. But we live in a time where the devil is working overtime on Americans. He hates America because this was the foremost light of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ for almost 200 years. 200 years God poured out the light of the gospel through American people. Now, I'm not saying he didn't use other people. I'm not saying he didn't use other countries. I'm just saying the truth is that God used the United States of America. And right now, Hollywood and everything that the devil can do, he's trying to get the American people not to believe or not to follow the living God. It's a terrible disgrace when you think about where this country comes from. And I got thinking the other day, I was watching, well, I wasn't watching, I ain't watched this thing in years, but there was a movie out. How many ever heard of Robin Hood? Prince of Thieves, and a guy by the name of Kevin something or other played in it, I think. Kevin Costner played in that. And I don't know if you remember about it, but there was one point where a little boy, a little kid, I think it was, comes up, and there's a colored man who is part of the party following Robin Hood. I don't think that's in the original. But anyways, it's Hollywood now, so Hollywood's going to help do its part for the devil. And Hollywood gets up this conjures up this scenario. So there's this colored fella hanging around with Robin Hood, and I have nothing against colored folk, nothing a bit, but I do have something against this statement. The young kid stands there, and he looks up at the colored man, and he says to the colored man, a little kid, and he says, "Did God paint you?" Cute little accent and all, you know. "Did God paint you?" And that reprobate looks down upon that little boy, and he says, "Did God paint me? Allah loves color." You see what he just did? He pulled our God and called him Allah. You know what Allah is? Allah is an imposter. Allah is an imposter. Do you know what the word imposter is? An imposter is one who assumes a character. Assumes a character for the purpose of deception. Allah, my friend, is an imposter of the God that I am preaching to you tonight. The God that I'm preaching to you tonight one time stood over the River Jordan, spoke all by himself, and said, "This is my beloved son." God has a son, amen. And Allah does not have a son. God has a son. And Hollywood is doing its best. Radio and television and TV, they're doing their best to get God out of your mind and out of your mindset. The greatest thing ever happened to your mind was to understand that God was real. Amen. That's the best thing ever happened to me, to find out that God cared. Blessed be God. Even the Father, the God of the Bible, has a son. The God of this universe is a father. Just like Mike Wasoski is a father and Bill Tyrell is a father, our Heavenly Father in heaven is a physical father to a physical son, the God that we serve. The God of the Jehovah's Witness is an imposter. He's an imposter. He is not the God of the Bible. He is not the God that created all things. He is an imposter. The Bible says about Jesus Christ that he, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. The God, the Jesus Christ of the Jehovah's Witness Bible, is a Jesus Christ that is not equal to God Almighty. He's an imposter God and an imposter Jesus. This country is full of imposters. They don't want the true God. They're not interested in the living. I want the living God. I don't know about you, but I want the living God around. I want him in the singing. I want him in the preaching. I want him in my daily life. I like going around. I like having God show up in the middle of Tuesday afternoon. You know what people don't like in America? They don't want God on Tuesday afternoon. They want to corner him and put him into Sunday and squash him into just about an hour and a half on Sunday and say, "I've done my part." I'll tell you one thing about God, all these imposters, and I hate these new Bibles that they got out. They're imposter Bibles. The God of the NIV is not the God of this book. The God of the NIV cannot count. All you got to do is read it. He cannot count. The God of the New King James is not the God of the Bible. He is not the Son. He is not the Jehovah of the Old Testament. He is an imposter God. You know what he's doing? He's putting on the show like he's the Word of God. The NIV and the New King James and the TEV and the ASV and the TED and the Living Bible and all them other EEEs that they can come up with. You know what they are? They're imposters. You know what an imposter cannot do? An imposter cannot be and cannot do what God can do for you. That's why the devil's trying to fill you with imposters. You know what the new Bibles want you to do? You know what the new The God of this world wants you to do? He wants you to come together on things you can agree on. I had a man tell me that just the other day, and he doesn't even realize what he said. He said, "Well, I hope we can come together on things we agree on." I'm not interested in coming together on things we agree on, when the things we disagree on is the fact that you think the NIV or the TEV or the King James, New King James, all that. I'm not interested. I'm not interested in coming together. Because in order to come together with you, I got to kick out God. And I want God in my life. I want God's book in my life. I want God's presence in my life. And bless God, I'll walk without you any day of the week. Amen. I want God. And if God comes at the cost of leaving the NIVers alone, I'll leave them alone. If it comes to leaving the imposter Bibles alone, I'm going to leave them alone. Why? I know something about God. You know what God said? God said, come out from among them and be ye separate. Not come together on your familiar things. Not come together on what you can all agree on, amen. God said, come out from among them, separate from them. I will receive you unto myself. I tell you what, it's funner walking alone with God than with multitudes who are not, amen. And I'd rather walk with God. I would rather walk with God. That Bible says, blessed be God. I tell you what, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's who I'm preaching to you tonight. I'm not preaching out of an NIV. I'm not preaching out of any of them fake, phony books. I'm not trying to sell you some Allah. I'm trying to preach to you, which no man, I believe, on the planet could possibly do for the integrity of what I should ought to be able to say about him. I'm going to try to preach to you the living God. The living God. You know one thing about him? He says, take your Bible and go to John chapter 6, verse 37. The God I'm preaching to you tonight, he is alive. He is alive. You know what I mean about alive? I mean, if you could put a stethoscope on him, you'd get a heartbeat, amen. I'm not talking about somebody who's out there somewhere out there. I'm talking about somebody who can talk if he wants to talk. I'm talking about somebody who sees what you do on a daily basis. I'm talking about somebody who is alive. I thank God for him being alive. The day I got saved, God was alive. The day I was in trouble, you know what I found out? I found out God was alive. You know who comes and helps me out? God. You know what they don't want in their life? God. God forbid. Paul says, blessed be God. You know what I think Paul is? I think Paul appreciates what God has done for him. And he says, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. One thing about God in John chapter 6. John chapter 6 and down at verse 57. One thing that distinguishes our God from any God on the planet is our God is alive. He is alive. He is the living Father. That's what Jesus Christ calls him. He says right here in verse 57, he says, as the living Father has sent me. He is alive, brethren. You know what's so good about God being alive? It means he can really help you out. It means he can really take care of you. You know what that Bible says? There's so many verses in there. It says about Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, John 6, verse 69. It says that we trust in the living God, 1 Timothy 6, 17. It says we serve the living God, Hebrews 9, 14. It says it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. He ain't dead, amen. And then why don't you to think that he cannot help you? He ain't going to be able to do anything for you because he's just dead. God ain't dead, my friend. God is very much alive. And if you don't think he's alive, he shows up from time to time, brethren. He shows up whether you want him to or not, amen. I've had God show up to me when I was out of the will of God and I was walking so far from God, God showed up. I'm like, how did you show up here? God says, because I'm interested in you. Well, why in the world would you be interested in me? I ain't walking, right? That's why I'm interested in you. You know what I found out? I didn't need my sister around. I didn't need some preacher around. God was fully capable of handling himself. You know why? Because he's alive. The Bible says we can depart. But if you depart, Paul says, I want you to know you're departing from somebody who is the living God. Living. Living God. It says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 9, 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 9, he's called the living and true God. There's one thing that's unique about the God that we serve is, brother, I don't have to make up stories about him. I don't have to make up excuses for him. I don't have to make people believe in him. I don't have to make up all kinds of things about how good God is. He just plain is good. I don't have to. You know what? If you think you have to make up things about God being good, you don't know him. You really don't know him. He is gooder than good. There ain't a good enough word in the English language to call him what he is. How could you possibly express the ability and the magnitude and magnificence that our God deserves to be called and to have some reprobate on a television show try to tell you and pass off a man by the name of Allah as God? It's preposterous. It's diabolical. It's ridiculous. Allah, I can't. You know what I love about my God? He don't need my help. But I'm sure glad he wants to give it. You know what Friedrich Nietzsche said about God? He looked across the world and he said this, and he lived in the 1800s to the year 1900. He died in 1900. He was born in 1844. And Friedrich Nietzsche said this. He said, God is dead. That's what he said. Friedrich Nietzsche. God is dead. That's what he's famous for. You know, one day, those two guys are going to meet. And Friedrich Nietzsche's the one that's dead. And God's going to bring him back to life so he can meet him. You know, it says it's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of the living God. You know why American, what's happened to a lot of Americans? They forgot. God's alive, brother. He is very much alive. He's watching what I'm saying tonight. He's watching what you're hearing tonight. He's watching what you're thinking tonight. Because he's alive. We serve a living Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I hear his voice of living. I see his voice of cheer. And every time I need him, he's always near. He's alive. I serve a living God. Deuteronomy chapter 32. One thing about God Almighty is he could never, in my opinion, God could never brag enough about himself. If you've ever read Isaiah's chapters of verses 40, or chapter 40, 41, 42, 43, all the way to 45, it is just God bragging on himself. And I think he could have done even more if he wanted to. But here's one thing about God Almighty in Deuteronomy chapter 32, if you would look down at verse, we'll pick it up in verse 39. I am so glad tonight that I don't have to stand up here and preach about somebody I don't believe in. I'm so glad I don't have to stand up here and preach about somebody I love when I don't love him, amen. I'm so glad I don't have to convince you you're loved not knowing I'm loved. You know what that Bible says in verse 39? It says, see now that I am he. He's a person. He's a person. He's the one that devised the plan of sending his only begotten son into this world to get you and I out of hell. My goodness, how you ought to get down and just praise him and thank him. And when you pray to him, don't pray to him like he's some puffy thing of air. He's a person. He is my heavenly Father. And you ought to call him Father. Father. He has sent forth the spirit of his son into your hearts crying, Abba, Father. He's a good Father. And now it says right here, he says, see now that I am he, and there is no God with me. I kill. You know, any of them fake, phony imposters can kill. Not a one of them can bring them back to life. My God brings them back to life. He stood at the tomb in Lazarus, and all he simply said was, he said, Lazarus, come forth. You know, and one preacher said, you know why he said Lazarus? He said Lazarus because if he just said come forth, the whole grave would have come out of the ground, amen. Why? Because all men live unto him. All he's got to do, there ain't a... Brethren, I tell you one thing about the God that I serve, the God that I preach for, the God that I know out of that book. Brother, there ain't nothing can limit him. Nothing. So he says right here, he says, for those of you who don't know me, for those of you who are full of Hollywood, for those of you who are stuck in the NIV and the New King James, the ASV and the TEV and every Bible you want so you ain't got to deal with me particular, he says, I want you to know something about me. He says, I am God and there is no God with me. I kill and I make alive. I wound and I heal. Neither is there any that can deliver out of my hand. I like verse 40. I love verse 40. It says, for I lift up my hand to heaven and say, I live forever. I tell you one thing about God is he ain't ashamed to let the world know I'm different. I'm not like the Ammonite God. I'm not like the Catholic God. I'm not like the Jehovah's Witness God. I'm not like Allah. And I'm not like any of those fellows that you think are so popular. I'm not like them. I'm the living God. And he says, I lift up my hand to heaven. Satan can't do that. Satan can impress and impose upon you anything he wants. But he cannot and will not be allowed by God Almighty to stand there and say, I live forever. And do it. Who's going to bring God down? That's the God you serve. I tell you what, you ought to get on board. You ought to get off your backside and get on board. You're serving the living God. So many of God's children act like they're serving this cardboard cutout of something. My goodness, he's the living God. That's who you serve. He took on Dagon all by himself. And that morning they came in there and they saw Dagon laid out on the threshold. And God just said, The next day they stand up poor Dagon. They all go out of the temple, fixed up Dagon, you know. But you know what God did that night? God comes in there and says, Dagon, what are you doing standing up? Remember, I'm the one that lifts up the hand of heaven. I'm the one that speaks. By the way, Dagon hit the dirt. Yes, sir. And you know what they found him? They found him in pieces the next time. You know who you serve? You don't serve some mamby-pamby something you heard on radio, brother. You serve the only living God. And brother, it would behoove you to get on board and start loving, serving, and obeying him. Because I'll tell you what, there ain't nothing like him. And when it comes time to reward you, he's going to reward you for having served him. I tell you what, there's a lot of people in America that are going to run into the living God and say, who are you? Well, God says, well, I saved you 20 years ago. You did? Why? What a thing. The judgment seat of Christ. What a day that'll be. Amen. You know what God says? He says, just in case you didn't remember this, he says, I live. I'm alive. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. There's one thing unique about him, is that he's alive. You know what else is unique about this God? This God wants to, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, you know what he wants? He wants to reconcile. He wants to reconcile. He doesn't want enmity. He doesn't want strife and animosity. He wants to, the God of this book wants to reconcile. You know what reconcile means? It means this right here. It means to bring back into union and friendship. That's the living God. You know, he's not going to be happy with you until you realize that he's your best friend. He's going to keep chipping away at your sin and chipping away at your blindness and chipping away at your foolishness and chipping away at your stupidity and chipping away at your stubbornness and chipping away and chipping away and chipping away and chipping away until you finally realize that he loves you. Good night. He sent Jesus Christ so he could start the reconciliation process. Amen. And the Bible says, if you would look in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, the God that we serve, the God of this Bible, he wants to reconcile. He wants to have union with you. That's an amazing thought, brother. There is nobody, a personage that has any kind of character like I'm preaching on tonight, and to think, and I know you don't even believe what I'm about to say, and to think that he wants to just talk with you. He really wants to talk to you. And I think about that, and I think, Lord, we're just a bunch of peons of nothing, and we're dumb, and we're foolish, and why in the world would you want to talk to us? He says, I don't know. But you know what God wants to do? He wants to talk to you. He wants to reconcile. He wants there to be a friendship. He wants there to be a union. It says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19, it says, to wit. That means to know something about him. To wit that God was in Christ. And these poor, pathetic fools who think Jesus Christ was just a good teacher, just a good man. Oh, he was a good teacher. He was a good man. But he was also God, manifested in the flesh. And when he walked on this earth, brother, he didn't have inside him what you got inside you. He had God Almighty inside him, all the whole thing, lock, stock, and barrel. And it was God inside of Christ. And what was he doing? What was God trying to do with Jesus Christ? Reconciling the world unto himself, himself, the person. You know, when you get down and pray tonight, you ought to get down and just say, Lord, I thank you for being my Lord and my Savior. And I thank you for dying for me on the cross. And I thank you for showing me the things about my Heavenly Father. But Lord, I want to have a relationship with my Father the way you had a relationship with your Father when you were down here on the earth. You know what I feel? I see, and I'm not a perfect prayer, but I've often heard people pray, and it's always Lord and Lord and Lord. You know, the Bible says the Spirit of God, when it's in you, and I'm not saying God ain't in you, I'm just saying that Spirit cries out, Father, Father, Father. I wonder if there's, I'm not saying you're not saved, please don't think that. But I'm wondering if there's a relationship schism. Because when God was here on earth in the form of his Son, Jesus Christ, when he prayed, Father, forgive them, they know not what they do. Father, in his prayers, he'd go out, Father. to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. Reconcile. What does reconcile mean? It means to restore to friendship. It means to restore to friendship. You ever have a good friend you got mad at? You ever get mad at a good friend? You don't want to talk to him anymore? You're going to show him how you got hurt and you want to hold back your friendship because I'm going to teach him a lesson. And then you go up to them and say, you know, I'll be in later. After you come to your senses, you go up to yourself and you look yourself in the mirror and say, you know, you've been stupid. And yourself says, yeah. You know, you got to go make sure your friend, yeah, I know. Well, go humble yourself. Oh, I hate that part. Make sure thy friend. So you go and you tell your friend, listen, I was being a jerk and can we let bygones be bygones? And all of a sudden he just says, yeah, man, let's let it go, man, let her go. And then used to reconcile. It's good to be reconciled with God, my friend. Yay. It is great to be reconciled with him. Jesus Christ, God was in him. You know what that Bible says in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18? He says, and it's an invitation from God himself. There's no man around, so if you ever did read your Bible and you wanted to pass it off that God doesn't talk to you, well, you ought to read Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18, because the Bible says, God says to you, come now and let us reason together. Now, I tell you one thing, you're going to have to talk to, he's going to have to be alive in order to keep that verse, brother. There's nobody, no God in the world can keep that verse unless he's alive. Come now and let us reason together. You know, you got problems I ain't got. You got cares I ain't got. You got concerns I ain't got. You got concerns I don't even want to know about. And yet God says, you come to me and you talk them out with me. You cast your cares upon me. I'll take care of them. Cast your cares upon me. I'll handle them. Don't you worry about it. He says, you got problems. You got things you can't figure out. Come now and let us reason together. You know what that is? That's just you and him talking together. You know what we got? We got a great God, brethren. We got a God who's willing to sit down and talk with you, reason with you, and help you out. Allah can't do that. Jehovah, God of the Jehovah's Witness, can't do that. The God, the Spirit that comes out of the NIV, the ASV, the TEV, and all them garbage Bibles, he can't do that. Different spirit, brother, different spirit. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit, and they are life. You take the NIV, I can show you verse after verse after verse after verse after verse where the words are different and where some of the words are gone. Different spirit comes out of that book, brother. Oh, brother, no, it's okay to just read them old Bibles. You're just a King James only Bible thumper. No, I just believe God. I believe God said, come now, let us reason together. So you start reasoning with him. He'll tell you, seek ye out the book of the Lord and read. You know what God is? God's an author. And he wrote one book. And he told you all about it. And he commanded you to read his. My people are going to have a time at the judgment seat of Christ. You know what I love about God? Is he doesn't need, I thank God for preachers, I am one. I thank God that God doesn't need preachers. I am so thankful that I come in here and I just preach a message or something and I'll say something about how God has done something for you and 15 faces all light up, all independent. Why? Because God was doing something for you and I wasn't even nowhere around. You know what that is to me? That's like, glory to God, amen. Because I see the joy of God on your faces, that's a blessing. To know that the living God has spent some time with some of you folks, that's a blessing, amen. And I like to see that. I like to know that God don't need me. Praise God, because if he needed me, boy, would we both be in bad shape, amen. You know what he wants? He wants to reconcile. He sent Jesus Christ to die upon a cross so that there could be no room for enmity on either side. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments, contained in ordinances, for to making himself a twain, one new man, so making peace. You know what God wants? The God of the King James Bible wants? He wants to have a peaceful relationship with just you. Just you. Just take everybody else out of this room and just you. And if you were the only one in Elbridge tonight, he would have this message preached if it was just you sitting there. I know preachers who do go to, when they start work, you know who all they preach to? Their wife. And sometimes their 6-year-old or 5-year-old kid. But God will lay on that man a message. And that man will go and preach that message just as he's preaching to a million people. And the only two people there is his wife and daughter. Why? They're important to God. He's alive. One last thing about the God of that book, the God that we serve. He's alive. He can be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. He can be reached. You ever call up somebody and says, "You've reached. You've reached the Richards residence. Sorry, we're not home." You know what the blessing is? When I really need to and I want help, I can go down on my knees and I can reach somebody else. And you know what's even a blessing is when he reaches back and he just makes everything okay. You say, "Brother, you're in la-la land." No, you don't know him. If you've never had a time where you've been on your knees where something comes from somewhere else and helps you out, you don't know him very well. He is able to comfort you in all of our afflictions. That's the next verse of the text I'm preaching on tonight. You know what else God wants? He wants to reconcile. He doesn't want enmity. He doesn't want there to be a schism. He wants unity. He wants friendship. But you know what else he wants? He wants to have a real relationship. A down-to-earth, walking, talking relationship. He didn't want you to die and go to hell. That's what all you had to do for that, for reconciliation, say, "Lord, come into my heart and save me. I don't want to die and go to hell." And Christ comes in and he reconciles the whole mess. But you know what God really wants? You see, the God of this Bible is not content with getting you out of hell. You're content with getting you out of hell. But you know what God wants? He wants a relationship. You know something about a relationship? Take your Bible and go to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16. I want you to see something about his relationship. 2 Corinthians chapter 6. You know what he wants? He wants a relationship. He wants a relationship. 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Look down at verse 16. He says, "And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple," and here he goes again, "of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them." You see what he wants? You see, the God of this Bible is not content with having you not dying and going to hell. He's not content with that. He wants to live with you. You know what the problem is? You sinful little dirtbag, you don't want to live around him. Because you know he's holy. And he don't want to live, and you know that he's going to pick up on your unholiness, amen. And he says, "You know what I want? I'm willing to dwell with you." Yeah, but you know what I think? I think like Peter. Peter, "Oh Lord, depart from me. I'm a sinful man." And you know what Peter, you know what he says to Peter? When Peter cries out that honest report, "Lord, depart from me. I'm a sinful man." He says, "Fear not. You better believe, hallelujah, because I'll tell you what, he is alive and he's holy can get, and he's still willing to put up with my sinfulness and help me through it. Praise God for my Savior. I am so glad that he is alive. I'm so glad that he has understanding. You know what understanding can do for a man? It'll cause the living God to look down upon my poor, pathetic frame. And he says, "Listen, Brother Mike doesn't have that problem." I said, "Yeah, but Father, I do." He said, "Yeah, but Brother so-and-so ain't got that problem." "Yeah, but Father, I do." Brother Bill Tyrell, he don't have that problem. "But Father, you know what God the Father does? He deals with you as an individual." Yeah, I am so thankful that he ain't a cookie-cutter God. I'm glad he don't have cookie-cutter people. How he can be so diverse and help you out like he helps you out and help me out like he helps me out. Why? Because of a relationship. You know, when you look at your kids in this church, I don't treat kids all the same. Because all kids aren't the same. You say, "Oh my God, brother, can't say that." Oh yes, I can. All kids aren't the same. You know, when you get a relationship with a kid, you get to know that kid. And one thing that would help one kid would hurt another. You know, you'd be hard on some kids, it'll turn them off so bad they'll walk away. You'd be hard on another and it'll straighten them right out. You ever notice that about some people? Must be God knows how to handle you, amen. Must be he's been spending some time with you, amen. Must be he wants a real relationship with you, amen. You know how he knows when to come in at just the right time? One thing I've noticed about God Almighty, boy, I tell you what, sometimes he don't come in soon enough for me. but he never shows up late. I've never understood that about him. He never shows up late. He just doesn't show up when I'd like him to. You know what that does show me, though? He says, Eric, I know you better than you know yourself. Well, Lord, why do you know me so well? Because I love you. And I've been watching you. Relationship. You know what mothers and sons have? Relationships. You know what fathers and sons and daughters have? They have relationships. You know Brother Joey Vasosky has a different relationship with his father than Elizabeth Vasosky? You know Elizabeth and Rebecca, they're almost like twins, but they're not. But they both have a different relationship to the father. Mike doesn't love either one any better than the other, but they both feel like they're loved the most. That's a relationship, brother. You know what God wants? He wants a relationship with you. He wants that. Verse 16. And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God, as he has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them. He wants to walk with me. That song says, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me that I am his own. I don't know about you, but I don't know how you can feel special when I'm the one that's special. I think you're deceived. I will dwell in them and walk in them. And I watch the relationship now, and I will be their God. I'm the living God, and he says, I will be yours. Man, what a privilege. What a privilege to have this one willing to acknowledge you and say, I'm his God. What a blessing. You see that young man over there? Yep. That's my son. You see that young lady over there? Yeah, that's my daughter. That verse says right there, the next one down says in verse 18 it says, and will be a father unto you. And ye shall be my sons and daughters. I don't know about you, but I tell you what, when I see the God of this, now I'm not preaching about the God of your imagination. I'm telling you the God of this book wants to have a relationship with you. And I could care less about what your imagination has conjured up as to why you two can't talk. Yeah, whatever you got, whatever you've conjured up, whatever little thing you've cornered yourself into, your God ain't the God of this book. The God of this book wants to have a talk and a fellowship with you. That's real. When I go home and see my father and my mother almost always meets me at the door to this day. She'll come right out. Even if it's bad out, sometimes she'll step right out with the blouse on and just, I think, Ma, get in there. You're going to freeze. You know what that is? That's a relationship. You know what God wants? He wants you to have the desire to have a relationship with him. You know what marks the Laodicean church? Not only that you're rich and increased with good and have need of nothing, but you know what earmarks the Laodicean church? Jesus Christ is on the outside of it. That's what earmarks are. The earmark of that Laodicean time frame is, let's get the picture, a bunch of Christians, born again people. And God Almighty is saying, I stand at the door. See, we use that as a text for salvation. And it's good for a text for salvation. But the doctrinal teaching of Revelation chapter 3 is this right here. I saved you and you don't want nothing to do with me. Why? Because you're rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing and knowest not that thou art miserable, poor, wretched, blind, and naked. I counsel thee to buy of me gold. You know what he wants? I don't know about you, but I look at the Laodicean church age and I go, I hate being part of it, but I love being part of it. You say, why would you say that? Because I've learned something about God Almighty. That's good. No matter what age you're in, no matter what part of the church age you are in, as long as God is with you, it don't matter what church I'm in. I don't care if I'm in the Smyrna church. I don't care if I'm in the worst of the churches that were ever in the church, period. When you got God with you, it's heaven. And it is good. The Philadelphia church age is no better than the Laodicean church age when you've got God in here and God and you are talking, walking. There is no difference, brother. But the thing of the earmarks of the Laodicean church is you don't want a relationship with me. The God of that book is not satisfied with you being saved. He's not satisfied until you go down on your knees and say, Father, you know, I've had a bad day. And you know, I don't go to my dad when I go up north. I don't get down and go, oh, Father. Father, I have. Father, this and Father, that. See, that's that old garbage from the Catholic Church. That's the Catholic God you're speaking to there. You see, the God up in heaven, the one I'm preaching to you tonight, has ears like you got. He has a dialect like you got. He understands. He can speak in the vernacular. Oh, most precious Heavenly Father. Puke City, buddy. You know what God wants? He wants you to just hit your knees and say, Lord, listen, this is how I am. And this is what's really going on in my life. And Lord, I want to get personal with you and I want to talk to you. And the Lord says, well, that's good because I want to get personal with you. Oh, amen. And I want to talk to you. Oh, amen. And when you have issues and problems, I want you to come to me. Oh, amen. And when you do something I don't want you to do, I'm going to bring it to your attention so you and I can deal with it. Oh. Oh. Oh, you are. Yeah, I am. Does that bother you? Well, if you would be honest with him right about there, you'd get over that. Because you would say, yes, Father, that bothers me because I have a lot of issues. I have a lot of problems. You go so much farther if you just be honest with him. Brother, he's living. He's alive. And he wants to have a relationship. I will be a father to you. That's what you need, brother. John says this right here, and I'll bring this message to a close. He says in 1 John, he says, truly, our fellowship is with the Father. Now, I mean no disrespect to the Son or the Lord Jesus Christ at all. But there is a difference. Blessed be the God, even the Father, of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I want to ask you a question. I didn't say you're not saved, and I'm not asking you if you're not saved, but do you have a heavenly Father? Because the Bible says you do. Number two, are you reconciled to your heavenly Father? Are you reconciled to your heavenly Father? Anything between you and your Father. We sing that song, you know. But you know it's hard to sing them songs when there's something between you and the Father. You need to reconcile to your Heavenly Father. And I want to say this too. That relationship is important to him. He wants a personal relationship to you. He doesn't want to be held at arm's length. He doesn't want to love from a distance. You know what I like about my wife? I like a lot of things about my wife. But you know what I really like about my wife? She loves to see me. You know what I like about my wife? She just loves to put her arms around me. You know what I love about my Heavenly Father? He loves to see me. I walked into Brother Don. I used to think Brother Donovan hated me. Well, I don't know if that's just how it is, but boy, I tell you what, when I went to PBI, I thought Brother Donovan didn't like me. I didn't know if he really cared for me much at all. And I mean, Brother Donovan's kind of hard to read, amen. So I had to go see him one day, and I just happened to have to walk into his room, and he gave me quite a shock that morning. How many of you ever seen Brother Donovan smile? That's a rare thing, amen. Well, you know, he showed me something about my Heavenly Father. He says there, and then my father had to show me about that. He said, you don't always know what you think you know. So I walked into Brother Donovan's office, and Brother Donovan had just walked into his office. So what he's doing is he's walking in like this. And as he's walking in, he's getting ready to turn around and sit down by his desk. And I step through the door, and he looks up and he goes, hey, Brother Richards, with a big smile on his face. Now, that's a scary thing just to think of in itself, amen. But that stopped me right there in my tracks. He was happy to see me. You know what my Heavenly Father is? He's happy to see you. He wants to have a relationship. If Brother Donovan tried to put his arms around me, I wouldn't let him. But I'll tell you what, brother. There is no greater blessing than being on your knees. You know, Brother LeGrecki, who's down here praying this morning, and I have a weird thing about prayer. And sometimes I think, you know, I'd like to go down and just kneel down with my brother in Christ and just pray with you. But I have a weird thing about it. Sometimes I think I'd probably jinx it. But you know one thing I love about God Almighty? Is when He comes into that room and I'm all by myself and He puts His arms around me and just tells me I'm His own. And we love each other. We sit there, we talk to each other. I cry, He laughs. He cries, I laugh. You know what we have? It's real. It's real. And I'm going to tell you something about God. He didn't die to get you out of hell. He died because He loved you. And His love goes far beyond getting you out of hell. And He's not going to stop until He has the relationship correct. You know, I encourage you tonight, if you need to reconcile, get reconciled with Him. If you're holding your Heavenly Father at an arm's length, you're missing the two greatest arms that will ever caress your soul. You need to put down the guard, put down the facade, and put down the image, and just ask Him to love you.
Even in death, He no fear.